This critique is a psychological and philosophical examination of modernity from the unique perspective of Professor Jacob Needleman. It is not the usual political talk show bashing of problems that we are forced to live with right now. Instead, he makes this serious subject matter interesting while still being academic. Examples of some of the problems of modernity are these: the ruination of our environment, the relativity of our legal system, living in the shadow of atomic and biological weapons, and the alienation of the worker due to mass production. I took my first philosophy class at San Francisco State with Professor Needleman on Plato. I found him to be one of the finest teachers I've ever had, because he shows sincere interest in his students' opinions. But most importantly for me, however, is that he was a catalyst for my acquiring further knowledge. So when I found out that he would be using Ouspensky and Genon as the main sources for his lectures on the fall semester in 2004, I knew I had to get this course on tape. What you will see now is a sampling of 28 hours of footage.
Call somebody a philosopher in the ancient world was to say they are trying to live a certain moral life in which truth is the most fundamental value. Levels of consciousness, levels of sensitivity, levels of understanding. When you're asleep, in bed, and dreaming, you are asleep. That's a certain state of consciousness. You may have good dreams, you may have bad dreams, but on the whole, they're still dreams. You may have insightful dreams, you may have confused dreams, but they're still dreams on the whole. Maybe there are special revelatory dreams sometimes, but that's not what I'm speaking about. I'm speaking about our everyday experience with this sort of thing. So you have sleep. And then you wake up and you're walking around like we're doing now and talking and seeing each other and looking at things and predicting things. And we could say that is another state of awakening, another state of consciousness. We're awake. So from sleep to being awake are two states of consciousness. I may go from one dream to a better dream, or from one dream, a confused dream, to a clear dream. And that's one, yes, that's a change. Good dreams, bad dreams, clear dreams, confused dreams, they're still all in this state of consciousness. But to go from a confused dream to a clear dream is one thing. To go from sleep to awakening is quite another state. There's no question that I'm in another state. You understand what I'm saying? You have states of hydrogen to oxygen. You have ice, solid. You have liquid. And you have that which is water. It's solid. And you have, say, steam, which is gas. These are states of matter. There are other states, too. But those are three states of matter, which you all recognize. So sleep and awake is like a different structure of the being at that moment. Now, the question we're speaking about here, is there another state, one way of looking at this question, is there an X which is our sleep is to awake as our awakening is to X? Is there another kind of awakening which is to this, what we call being awake, as being awake is to being asleep? Why should we think that these are the only two necessarily states of consciousness possible? Experience of the inner world, interior experience, experience of the world within the mind, the world within the soul, the world within the self. Science has gone very far by emphasizing outer empiricism, that is to say, empiricism directed to what Uspensky calls the visible world. Through the senses, through the sense of taste, touch, smell, etc., sight, and the great instruments of science, including the mathematics of science, all being instruments by which one extends the senses and extends the intellectual power of organizing the data which the senses bring back. And that is all great and fine, but it's based on the veridical or the standard of external experience of the senses. But is there such a thing as internal experience? And the answer that the great traditional teachings offer, the great esoteric teachings, the mystics offer, is a resounding, deafening yes. There is inner experience, very, very deep and very potentially deeply developed. And we, modern people, are like infants stumbling around in comparison to some of the great mystics and visionaries who had actual experience, but not the kind of experience that you can put in a laboratory. And in that sense, why I try to draw the analogy between an insane asylum full of crazy people who are having flawed experience, a madman, psychotic, whatever else they are, is someone who has flawed experience. If I'm hearing Martians beaming messages to me in my skull, I say, I'm experiencing that, Doc. I can hear them. Look, there's one now. Look, right behind you. Look here. I'm sorry, he's nuts. That's the technical term. Guy is nuts. I'm sorry, I'm joking. He's got a problem with his experience. I was a therapist for a year, and I was being trained to treat schizophrenics those days, and my training me were psychiatrists, very accomplished, and there was no question there was such a thing as people who were crazy. We gave them fancy names, and we said we felt sorry for them, we sympathized, we tried to help them, but they were crazy. Every third person that came into the office was hearing voices on the radio here. People would come in like this and stand there for 3 or 4 hours. They were Christ. And one psychiatrist developed a very strong way of treating these people, and it became very popular for a few years until it became exaggerated and nobody would use it anymore. But he would shock them. These were called catatonics in those days. And somebody would come in like that. He would say, Jesus, that's the fourth blankety-blank Christ I've seen this morning. And the guy would go like that. And he would move his arms for the first time in maybe a month because he was shocked. According to Plato and according to many of these people, we live in a world of self-deceptions, world of appearances. And most of our emotional life is spent reacting to fantasies about paranoid or one other kinds, about what other people are saying or thinking, of what's going to happen to us and what isn't going to happen to us. And we rarely see things for what they are. Plato speaks about this in the allegory of the cave, where he says, we are all like people living in a cave, looking at shadows on the wall, shadows of objects that are passing behind us and with light thrown by a fire onto the wall, and we don't ever even see the real objects behind us. that are casting these shadows. We live in a world of appearances. We don't really know things that we can be very clever. We can predict the movements of the shadows. We can even win the Nobel Prize for predicting which shadows follow which. But to actually see the reality, we don't. And he says we have to turn around. And we can't turn around just our head. The head doesn't go. He has this very clearly. He says we are chained to the cave, and we have to turn our whole being around, our whole body, in order to see the reality. And then, when we see that, then comes the long climb up out of the cave to the real world with trees and mountains and leaves, and then the sun, the source of all light and energy.